So, hello everyone. So my name is Reese Lindmark, and I was, as Heather said, a co-founder or a co-organizer of ETH Denver. But today, I'm going to be talking about this project called ETH Commons, but actually more the why, the deep why behind ETH Commons, which is why we call it this catalyzing a deep mindset change given our current context, which is fragile but abundant. So let's dive in. We're going to talk about the why and understand everybody's deep whys, and we'll give some pieces on what context we're in right now, and then we'll talk about what you can do. So this is going to be an interactive portion. So what we're going to do is 30 seconds by yourself. You're going to find your deep why, and your deep why is where you ask yourself, well, why do I do what I do in the world? Why do I do my professional stuff? And then once you answer that, you ask that again and say, well, why do I do that? Well, why do I do that? And after you ask yourself five whys, you'll find your deep why. Okay? So let's give everybody gonna take 30 seconds to silently think of your deep why. Begin. More seconds, ask yourself why one more time. Why do you do the things you do in the world? Okay, now what you're going to do is you're going to share with a partner. So find someone close to you and ask them and share your deep why with them. Have them tell you your deep why and you tell them your deep why. And go!
We're not cyborgs yet.
We're not cyborgs yet. Okay, so yes, that's true. And that is the hope, is that the state? I'm not sure. Okay, sweet. So I'll tell you about my deep why and why it's true. So my deep why is to catalyze the humanity scale phase shift from hashtag late stage capitalism to what's next, which is game B, this world of abundance, long term human flourishing. So to understand why that's true, let's dive into the context. The context, right now, we have a bunch of fragility. This is from massive, converging, exponential technological change. We also have abundance from all the technological progress that's happened. And the fragility means it's necessary that we do this big phase shift. And the abundance means that we can, that we have enough to do this phase shift. So let's talk about the fragility piece first. I think a lot of us know this intuitively. These are just a bunch of tech buzzwords, but biotech is happening, AI, robotics, VR, AR, blockchain, crypto, IoT, self-driving cars, all this stuff is happening in parallel at once right now. And a lot of venture capital funding is going towards it, and this is because we've changed the generative function for how we create value in the world. So, to understand what that looks like, so these are these fun system graphs that I made. So this is the tech society loop, how technology forms society, and then that then changes technology, and they kind of loop with each other. Right now it's getting a lot and a lot faster. So we'll watch that one more time just to get the vibe for it. But we create technology, that technology informs our society, what happens in society, and then society changes technology. And this is essentially how the loop that we live in, and it was was going relatively slowly, but now, as you can see, it's going much more quickly, and it will be relatively intense. So why is this true? What changed in what I call our generative function? This is because we now have 4 billion people online with smartphones. So 20, 25 years ago, no one was online, no one had a smartphone. Now, 80% of adults will have are going to be online and have a smartphone. And what that means is, this is kind of a little wacko one, but what that means is that our value loops are a lot faster. So what I mean by that is if you look here, you have this learn one, can you see that? See, it's a lot easier to learn than it was. Google things, there are MOOCs, there's all that stuff. To create things, it's a lot easier. There's a lot of underlying open source and other kinds of infrastructure. There's lots of SaaS platforms, and it's distributed. Now you can distribute stuff to 4 billion people, you know, with their very smartphones. So our learning, our value creation loops are a lot faster. So this, all this value creation, it would be awesome, and it's going to be awesome, except that our technological progress is incentivized, essentially through capitalism, to ignore externalities. What I mean by that is, if I'm competing versus another company over here, and I decide to be good for the environment or whatever, and it costs me more, and then I lose to them in a competitive environment. So, when you think about it, if the Industrial Revolution created climate change as its ignored externality, that's what we ignored throughout the Industrial Revolution, then all this digital revolution and the massive converging exponential technology might create something like self-extinction as an ignored externality. So that's the fragility piece, kind of intense. So it means that it's necessary to fit phase shift to gain B, but the abundance means that we can actually do so. And what I mean by abundance is we made a lot of macro progress as a society, and as an individual, we feel like we have enough. So macro progress, so this is a graph over time of the world average income, and you can see for thousands of years, it was pretty much flat line, and then something weird happened, aka the Industrial Revolution, and now things are going way up and to the right at an intense exponential curve. And a way to look at this and why this is creating abundance in reality is, so these are graphs, these are six different graphs of essentially metrics of success for humanity. So the top left is extreme poverty, and you can see that this is over the last 200 years. So you can see extreme poverty, 200 years ago, you know, 94% of people lived in extreme poverty. Today, almost no one lives in extreme poverty. 10% of people live in extreme poverty. Basic education, no one used to have basic education. Now everybody does. For literacy, no one used to be able to read. Now almost everybody can read. For democracy, half of people didn't live in democracy, or no one lives in democracy. Now half of people live in a democracy. No one was vaccinated. Now almost everybody's vaccinated. Half of kids used to die before the age of 5. Now almost no kids die before the age of 5. So in the last 200 years, things have gotten a lot better from a macro perspective. But things are also a lot better and abundant from a micro perspective. So this is a graph of individual income on the x-axis. And it's a log scale, so it doubles, versus happiness on the y-axis. And these are four different kinds of how you can measure happiness, essentially. And you can see, after about $40,000 a year, right around $50,000, you stop getting happier when you make more money. So it's like, I'm making more, I make more. After that point, more money doesn't make you happier. So that's kind of a crazy different thing in society, is that now, go out there and make more money, but actually it doesn't make you happier. We've reached that point of enough or abundance. So that's the current status quo, is we have this fragility as a result of essentially the digital revolution and these massive converging exponential technologies, and we also have abundance from the Industrial Revolution, and now we're at this point where we have enough where more money doesn't equal more happiness, and where at a macro level things are a lot better than. So, if we want to actively make this phase shift, what can you do? There are pretty much what we're trying to do is solve these system level coordination problems. And you do that primarily by having two kind of mindsets. One is this non-accumulation mindset, so stop trying to accumulate wealth or whatever, especially because it doesn't make you happier. And then the second is to have a shared outcomes mindset. So that means you're thinking about the whole system, you're internalizing your externalities, things like that. So let's talk about two kind of versions of this. One is called the crypto pledge, which is a self-imposed income tax for good, and the other is called ETH Commons, which is this collaboration mindset towards shared outcomes in the Ethereum ecosystem. So the crypto pledge is a meme. It is not an actual entity that does stuff at this point. But you can see that here are some examples of people doing crypto pledge-like things where they're actively giving back to the system. So Mary Merkel here in Toronto, $200,000 to a homeless kid here. Vitalik gave $750,000 to this AI safety thing called Miri, $1 million to this thing called GiveDirectly. $2.4 million to support anti-aging research. Ripple recently gave $30 million to fund all 35,000 projects on this thing called Donors Choose, which is for teachers. And this final one is a thing called the Pineapple Fund, where they donated $86 million of Bitcoins to charity. And the line down here is exactly what I'm saying, which is because once you have enough money, money doesn't matter. So that's some examples of the crypto pledge. I myself am doing a crypto pledge variant, so I am peer funded by the ecosystem. What I mean by that is I have a Patreon, which is like Kickstarter, but for subscriptions. So I get paid a certain amount of money per month. So I got 50 patrons at about $900 a month, and then this thing called Stake Tree, which is like Patreon, but for ETH. And some people fund me on that as well. So I'm peer funded by the ecosystem, but I have a rule that states, hey, after that, essentially giving 50% of all the money I make after $4,000 a month. So here's how much money I made per month. I just wrote a big article about this. Here's how much money I made per month in November, December, January, and February. I made about $5,000 a month every month. You can see here is like what percent of that, how much was greater than $4,000, and then of that, what is 50% of that number? So I got to $3,000 as a number where it's like, okay, this money's not making me happier. I'll give 50% of it back to the system, back to charity. So I recently gave $3,000. And just as a note here, I think $3,000 is not, I mean, in the big scheme of things within crypto, it's not very much money. But for me, personally, it was a good amount of money. It was 16% of my net worth. And you can see here's my Wells Fargo and my MetaMask account, which seems quite. There will be a time at which I am sad that I posted this publicly, but today is not that day, or I hope it's not that day. So that is the crypto pledge. And the key thing with the crypto pledge is that it's very powerful. So I have an iPhone with $1,000. I currently have an iPhone 5S. It gets cold outside, has a bad battery, it's got all kinds of issues. And so I could, $1,000, get a new iPhone X for me. And that would help me out in lots of ways. But that $1,000 also can support 3 years of basic income for someone in Kenya. And basic income has been shown to just help people with long-term thinking. So it's like, that seems really powerful. Or with that $1,000, you can essentially do 75 years worth of carbon offsets for the Earth. So it's like, hey, if you're trying to offset your life and diminish the risks of climate change, things like this, pretty effective. So this is kind of an example of the impact that you can have. When you look at it like this, you're like, well, I shouldn't do the thing for me because these two other things are really powerful for everybody else. So with that, that is the crypto pledge mindset. It is a non-accumulation mindset, and that non-accumulation mindset allows you to stop working in these kind of win-lose environments, in these kind of hoarding environments, and start to actively give back to the system to kind of start to internalize your externalities, help other people have long-term thinking as well. So that's that. The other thing is the ETH Commons. Again, it's more of a hashtag than it is an actual thing. So it's a kind of a group of people who support the Ethereum Commons. But more than anything, it's this self-tax mindset for companies and this like collaboration win-win cross-project co-evolution mindset as well. These are things that I'll be giving some examples here of things that have happened in the Ethereum ecosystem that were not done by me or other people within ETH Commons, but are just examples of this mindset. So here's kind of people within ETH Commons doing the self-tax crypto pledge mindset. So we don't need to go through all these, but they're good examples. So you have the Ethereum Community Fund, the ECF, which has six different ETH projects, a bunch of big names there, who all gave to support, I think it's a $100 million fund to support Ethereum infrastructure. So these are people that essentially solved the coordination problem. You know, that infrastructure could have just been tragedy in the commons way, but they all came together and they said, nope, we're going to work on this, we're all going to self-tax ourselves and give to support this underlying infrastructure. And there are lots of other examples of this. ETH Prize is a version of that that has these two big infrastructure grants. Consensus does a lot of this work. Coinbase gives 25k a month to support open source infrastructure. This is all in addition to the Ethereum Foundation doing their grants. So this is this mindset of people within the ecosystem saying, hey, we have enough, we want to support the infrastructure to continue this new ecosystem in this new world. Another version of it is this kind of collaboration or shared outcomes perspective. So this is, in places where you traditionally see competition, we're seeing more collaboration. Some examples of this are up here. There are these cool Plasma implementation calls. So this is where groups from all over, from Omise, from Ethereum Foundation, from Cosmos, they all get together and they say, hey, I think it's once a week, maybe once a month, they get together. They're all trying to do the same thing. They all have the same shared goal. And you think that they might be competing with each other, but instead they get together and talk about their shared challenges and how each of them are working through them. And that same mindset is true with this thing called Scaling Now, which was this big event on scaling, with these decentralized exchange workshop, where a bunch of people from the DEX ecosystem, from the decentralized exchange ecosystem, they came together and they essentially workshopped a bunch of the challenges that they're all having. Even though they're competitors, they're existing more in a co-opetition or co-evolution kind of mindset. So that's happening. One of the notes maybe on these crypto economic primitives is, so I host these kind of shared calls between various groups in the space that are working on problems, and even though they're working on similar problems, they kind of come together and talk about how they can collaborate on those problems. In a non-competing kind of mindset. So to conclude, the situation is as follows. We have the fragility from the massive, converging, exponential technological change. But we also have this abundance from technological progress. And so I would encourage everyone to ask yourself, what is your deep why? What are you thinking about? Why are you working in the world these days? And for me, I find it very powerful to have this abundant, non-accumulation, collaborative mindset. And here are some hashtags that I'm working on that have that. So with that, okay, I can take some questions from the audience or concerns or anything that you would like.
Okay, I have a question. So you mentioned
the
Plasma
Open
Project
with
Cosmo.
Yep.
Can you tell us a little bit about that project, please?
About Cosmos? Yes. So Cosmos is an interchain solution to, I don't know that much about Cosmos, but they're essentially an interchain protocol that allows for multiple chains to talk with each other, and they're making this thing called Tendermint, which is a version of Ethereum, but with a proof of stake consensus mechanism that you can use Tendermint instead of coding directly in Ethereum. And for this presentation, the key thing is that Cosmos is a key player within the Ethereum and blockchain ecosystem, and Cosmos actively self-tax themselves to give money to support Ethereum infrastructure.
Cool. Perhaps this is new, but it seems striking that there's this much collaboration within the Ethereum community. Do you think there's actionable ways that we can forward this aside from these two worthy competitors?
At a high level, it comes from everybody who's in the Ethereum community having this mindset towards each other. So for example, at ETH Denver, there were lots of good examples of this, but one of them was this guy Sid from Tushy and Pete from CypherBrowser. They're both making a very similar product, trying to get more mobile Ethereum users. They both gave a presentation together and then answered the Q&A together around this. So having that mindset, I think, is step one. And then once you have that mindset, then yeah, I think it's things that you can do are, if you work for a company, encourage collaboration with other people who exist in the ecosystem, and then also to actively start funding some of these common goods. And you can fund it either through traditional means, through the like big ecosystem stuff like Ethereum Community Fund, but a lot of people fund this stuff through like the bounty networks like Gitcoin or Bounties Network or Status.
Any other questions?
Well, thank you again so much.